Community Committee. My name is Brian Mays. I'm the city councillor for St. Vital Ward. I'll be chairing today's meeting, joined virtually by Councillor Allard from somewhere in St. Boniface and joined by Councillor Chambers here in the council chamber, as well as city planners and city clerks. We meet today on Treaty One land, the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation. Madam Clerk, I assume we need to approve minutes of the previous meeting?
Correct, January 4th.
So Councillor Chambers, if you can move those.
So moved.
And all those in favor?
Aye.
All right, that's carried. And then a rather long list of delegations. We need to add Mr. Ottenbright, I think.
Correct. If I could have the suspension of the rules, there was an error on my part for Mr. Albright adding to the agenda. We could just suspend the rules to add him as delegate number six on that matter.
I'll move that.
Thank you. So we have moved to suspend the rules and add that additional delegate from the legendary basketball Ottenbright family of St. Vital. Barry Ottenbright is with us. So all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, thank you. Madam Clerk, on we roll.
Okay, so the first delegation we have is joining us via Zoom. We have Mr. Jeff Scott of Southwood Golf and Country Club to speak to plan approval item report number three for AD Rue des Ruines de Monastère. So I see that we have the delegate with us now. We could just get you to unmute yourself. Thank you. You're now live with the Riel Community Committee. You have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation.
Thank you very much. My presence here is just to answer any questions. David Kresak is presenting on behalf of Southwood Golf and Country Club's application for a building permit.
I know about this.
Yeah. All right, any questions?
Yeah, just for clarification, it's an expansion of your existing hunt room for the purposes. You're not expanding per se in occupancy, but expanding in terms of size. This will address a lot of the way that we used to do business in terms of putting, say, 200 people into a room that's 200 square foot large. You're expanding it to keep the same number. There'll be more distancing of the tables and accommodating people that way.
That's correct.
You've summed up my thoughts eloquently.
All right.
Thank you.
If there are no further questions, on to the next delegate, I guess, then.
Certainly. Okay, so the next delegate is speaking on the same topic, plan approval report number three. We have Mr. David Kresak of LM Architectural Group. And Mr. Kresak is just joining. Hi there, you're now live with the Riel Committee and you have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation.
All right, good morning, everybody. I think per the application that we made, Southwood Golf and Country Club is looking to undertake a modest expansion to their clubhouse, expanding their existing member dining room. The expansion is about 400 square feet, adds about 12 seats to their current member dining room without increasing the overall seating capacity of the clubhouse. It remains at 200 seats the way it is currently, and this seating is really being reallocated from their large member dining room. As indicated in the illustrations that were provided, this expansion is happening beneath an existing roof overhang on the front of the clubhouse. So it's an area of outdoor patio surrounded by exterior columns. We're pushing the exterior walls out to those columns and converting that now to interior space. The roofline doesn't change the overall impact of the building on its surroundings is not changing, and no modifications to any of the approaches, entrances, drive aisles, etc. So again, just a very small expansion in order to meet the dining demands of the current membership. As stated in our intent statement, overall building occupancy of 450 remains. Again, seating capacity at 200 remains And there is no impact on any of the other protected areas of the property, in particular the Oak Grove, which is on the southwest corner of the property. That is several hundred yards away from the proposed expansion. So with that, I'm open to any questions from any of the members.
I have a question for the planner, if my colleagues don't have any questions. I assume then that this would add all of Southwood Golf Course to the settlement area map that we have been given a few years or so ago, and we were told areas like Niagara Golf Course, Winter Park Golf Course weren't part of the settlement area in 1971, and now they are part of the settlement area because somebody took out a building permit in 1973 for a starter's hut at Winter Park Golf Course. Even though the clubhouse dates to 1922, our map defines it as not settled in 1971, but part of our narrative that there's been an explosive 92% growth in the settlement area, although so often columnists and pundits refer to that as the built-up area, understandably. So would this now deem all of Southwood Golf Course, which is probably 60, 70 acres, I'm going to guess 60 acres conservatively, would that now all be included as part of the settlement area of the city of Winnipeg?
That would be, sorry, coming in from video here, Councillor. I assume you're referring to the draft complete communities direction strategy, what's referred to the existing built-up area there?
Yes.
My understanding is, of course, it's obviously still a draft. My understanding is that is within the built-up area in the draft. Elise can add anything or correct that, but that's my understanding.
So we changed the name of that because we were referring to two areas such as Sage Creek in one map as the built-up area and in the next map as outside of the existing built-up area. So I thought we changed the terminology on that. To intensification target area. So is this currently in the intensification target area?
We can, we'll follow up with the Complete Communities team of planners who are working on that just to confirm exactly what this area is defined as in relation to your question, because I don't have that map in front of me. I only have the information of the current complete communities.
You're using completely different criteria for 1971 and the current day map. Of course you're going to create a large increase in area. I mean, the map indicated all of the Canoe Club, Niagara, and Winter Park golf courses were settled now, and they weren't in 1971, which was a nasty shock to people at the Canoe Club, given that the course opened in 1918. So I'm not sure how they're playing in the unsettled wild prior to 1971, but I guess they were. So yes, if we can have some clarification on that, a starter's hut in 1973 resulted in 60 acres at Winter Park suddenly being deemed settled and being part of the larger narrative that our sprawl is uncontrolled, even though the clubhouse was built in the 20s, I'd be interested to know if we're now going to define Southwood as part of the built up area.
As it stands, it's part of the rural and agricultural policy area within the current council approved complete communities. So,
well, even though the clubhouse is probably only a few years old, it would seem that adding an addition to other places seems to have completely changed the characterization by the planning department. So yes, if I could have somebody clarify that for me.
We'll get back to you on that.
Yeah, we can.
Thank you. Next delegate, please.
All right, so moving on, we have Jonathan Freed of Freed Home Development to speak with regards to plan approval for 316 Bisneron Street, which is report number 4. And we are admitting Jonathan now.
Who used the alias Barry Freed for many years? That's a trivia question for you. Abby Hoffman.
Hi, John. If we could just get you to start your video. We are now. Thank you. You're live with the Real Community Committee, and you may begin your presentation.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Rebecca, Brent Bellamy is going to do the presentation exclusively. So I'm just going to
use the alias Barry Freed for many years.
John, if we could just mute the YouTube as well. Hi, John.
John, you set the bar high with your video backdrop last time. So we'd hope for something more whimsical, but there you go.
This is the fourth generation picture. That's all you get. But Brent is going to present on behalf of the group. So I'm just going to turn off my video and mute myself.
Can we reset the clock? Or is it?
John, are you looking to present at all or to speak at all?
I won't be presenting. I don't think at this time.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. So then we have admitted our next delegate, which is Brent Bellamy of Number 10 Architectural Group, to speak on the plan approval for 316 Bismarck Street. Hi, Brent, you're live now.
Okay. I'll share my screen. Can you see it?
Yeah, I can see it.
Okay. Thanks for having us. I'm presenting 316 Demiron. I'll be quick. It's not moving forward. Oh, there we go. This is the site. It's on Demiron between Goulet and Marion on the Goulet side. You can see it's a continuation of the sort of high density development between Goulet and Marion. We're continuing that further out from downtown. And it has, the site has high connectivity. Seven bus stops are within 100 meters of the site. It's on a future bike lane and has very high connectivity to downtown and other areas in the neighborhood. This is the site itself. You can see it's not a very pedestrian friendly environment. It's a bit of a repelling condition for pedestrians and cyclists. It's a very high volume vehicle traffic intersection. And our hope is that our new building will help to create a bit of a different character for the street. This is the site plan and the main floor plan. Some of the details of the project: it's a six-story building, 65 residential units, has two commercial units at grade, 71 on-site parking stalls, and 60 of those are interior within the building itself, so not exposed onto the street, 18 bicycle parking stalls, and four bike parking stalls on the outside. You can see by the layout of the plan, we've tried to maintain all the active uses of the building to the sidewalk face. One commercial unit that can be divided into two facing the intersection, creating an animation on the sidewalk itself. The fitness room and the lobby of the residential building pushed right to the sidewalk, so the building does have that real pedestrian friendly feel at grade. We've pushed the building back at the north side to create a small patio space. Hopefully that will entice a more community oriented use for the commercial units and create a sort of a nicer pedestrian feel at that edge. We're planting five trees along the boulevard to help create some shade and make the site feel a little bit more residential, a little friendlier. And the garbage you can see is a type of garbage that isn't a BFI. It's set into the ground, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. But it's a really nice treatment that keeps the garbage sort of clean and not with a BFI pushed out onto the sidewalk or people dumpster diving, that kind of thing. It's a really nice setup. I'll talk about that later. This is the second floor, second to sixth actually. You can see the building is pushed. The residential building is pushed back from the sidewalk to create a one-story terrace that creates these second level rooftop terraces that add to that eyes on the street, that feeling of animation on the facade. And all the residential suites also have balconies to help contribute to that. This is the facade of the building, seen from the ground level. Our hope was that we would sort of take the historic character of St. Boniface, the historic architecture of St. Boniface, and combine it with the sort of the industrial feel of the area itself, the immediate area, to create a piece that's has a bit of personality and some character on the street that becomes a bit of a local landmark. You know, the building with the arches. We created this pedestrian facade of arches all the way down to really give the building some personality and a modern character, not just your typical apartment building. This is a view to the along the street. You can see there's a very strong pedestrian edge. This is that setback area at the north to have a small patio if we could find a use for that. And you can see the hope is to really create a very strong pedestrian feel. This is showing the setback and sort of the really high quality materials that we're using. It's masonry, it's lap siding, and it's weathering steel and large windows, lots of glass, both in the units and along the sidewalk, to create a building that feels quite permanent and is a substantial contributor to the neighborhood, the architecture of the neighborhood. You can see this is showing the facade with the really nice colonnade of arches along the sidewalk, giving the building some real personality, and how the massing really comes in and out to provide some articulation on the facade. And just the bird's eye view, showing how the patio works at the north side and how that building setback creates that podium that really connects to the neighboring buildings. And then a view from the main entry, showing that transparency from the sidewalk to the inside of the building. And then this is the north face. And just up here, you can see this is what the inset garbage containers will look like. So they actually have a really nice finish to them. They don't need to be screened or anything. And they sort of, they stop the dumpster diving and people putting larger things like mattresses in them. They keep that area quite clean. That's where we can put it up onto the public sidewalk, actually. And so you can see this is just the north face, some nice large windows, and the parking is really hidden completely from the sidewalk. It's other than the few stalls along the lane, it's internal to the building. And then these are the trees that we're planting along the boulevard. And that's all I have.
Any questions?
Yeah, we have discussed this building before previously, correct?
We did, yeah.
That's right.
So what was approved on it?
We approved the rezoning at council. This is not the plan approval.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I have a question.
Yeah, it's a beautiful building, and looking at the architecture of it, how it incorporates the street with the streetscaping with the overhead or the mezzanine level gathering area, outdoor gathering area, absolutely beautiful. I think it's going to be a great addition to the St. Boniface area.
Thank you.
Councilor Eller?
Yes, I was wondering how many three bedroom units are incorporated in the plan.
We have one stack of three bedroom units in the north corner, so there's 5 3 bedroom units.
Excellent. There's a dearth of 3 bedroom units in St. Boniface ward, and many young families want to move there, and this is a way where they can do that. So thank you very much for incorporating that into the plan.
Am I misreading something? I thought this was the one. There was one in June of 2015. It was a surface parking lot. It had to come to appeal. It was member Chan was coming on appeal on the Sport for Life building. And then there was a surface parking lot. You had to get that approved with construction above. But this is maybe I'm misremembering it from a different building. Is this one got that as well, the surface parking with the building up above? Or is that a different one we've been dealing with? Because it wasn't this is like that one back in 2015 where we had to go to appeal to get approved for the surface lot with the building above. But am I misremembering this is another one?
Only parking on the ground floor. It was like a building on stilts.
Yeah.
This is not that.
This is not, okay.
Yeah. This has actual active uses at grade.
Okay.
So they've got commercial units, the gym, and the entry area, lobby.
Must be thinking of another one. Okay, thanks. Okay, thank you. On to the next delegate, please.
Thank you.
So I have Loren Basham and Barry Odenbright, but I'm understanding they might not be interested in speaking. We're going to admit them and allow this opportunity. Hi, Loren, you're next up in delegations if you wish to address the committee.
Thank you.
So I have Loren Basham and Barry Odenbright.
Loren, can I get you to mute the YouTube stream?
I will not miss that problem. Let me go back.
Hi, Loren, you're live with the Rail Community Committee if you're interested in addressing the committee.
No, I'm good. I think Brent did a great job.
Okay, thank you. And Barry, we have you live at the moment as well. Would you like to address the committee?
No, I'm fine.
Okay. Well, then we are finished with our delegation portion.
Barry, I was at the Bonnie Vittel soccer building not long ago and was admiring it again. Some very good work done there. Few years back by yourself, so it stands up well.
Loren worked on that one as well.
Well, and my congrats to Loren as well. That's been a good investment. Questions.
I spoke too soon. I've got Walter Kleinschmidt as well that registered with us on Friday, who is in delegations to appear on this item. Apologies.
Okay, so if we're not hearing more from number 10 and associates, then on we go to Walter.
Rebecca.
Hi, Walter. I'm sorry about that.
This is Jonathan. Ask if I could.
Oh.
I have a question for Jonathan. I would like him to say what he wants to say.
Okay, Jonathan.
Hi, thank you. I just wanted to add that we are trying to create an agreement with a local. I don't want to mispronounce it, but it's a CFAFM, I believe. We're trying to create a some sort of partnership agreement to basically incentivize and to allocate units or suites, I should say, for seniors. So we're eagerly trying to complete that partnership to really create a real social impact for the St. Boniface neighborhood and community.
Do you mean l'Association des aînés francophones Manitobains?
That sounds right.
Okay, so the French Seniors Association.
Yes.
Got it. Thanks.
That's all I have to add, I believe. If anyone, Councillor Lard, do you have any questions for me?
No, I don't. The project looks great, and I see it has the support from the public service. We'll see what Walter has to say, and thank you very much for the presentation.
Thank you.
Okay, with apologies, again, we have Walter. Bienvenue. You have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation.
Good morning to all, Councillor Mays and the committee members. I'm here on behalf of the Association of Old St. Boniface to express our support to the plan submitted for 316 Demiron. I've sent you a letter explaining a bit our role and why we're doing this, but I just wanted to skip over it. Hopefully you'll read it at your leisure because we think it's significant. We are pleased to confirm that the proponent personally sought our association's input and met with us and others. The discussion was open, responsive, and left us confident that a project of good for the developer and for the area was in the making. We consequently support the plan and add only one important clarification in respect to the CRUs shown on the plan. CRUs are not a defined term in the Winnipeg zoning bylaw, from what I can tell. I searched for it extensively. In this context, and through conversation, we assume it means commercial retail units.
Okay, I was going to ask what that was. Thanks.
And as such, we want to reinforce the relocation of retail in the specified ground floor area of the project. We submit that this is consistent with the intent of the proponent, as discussed, and is generally assumed in the context of Winnipeg Services report on the subject, which I quote in the letter for your ready reference. The subject site is consistent with complete community direction strategy, which supports active use such as retail and services at street level and offices on the upper levels of a multi-story building. What we don't really want to see are offices, which basically end up with curtains in the windows so the staff can work with some privacy, and therefore it's an inactive storefront. But it has happened here and there in St. Boniface and other places. And the second criteria is when the applicant has worked closely with the urban planning division. And again, it's asking for a high quality pedestrian oriented urban environment, a strong pedestrian oriented ground floor design that incorporates small scale, fine grained commercial storefronts, which to maybe means primarily retail, which also includes food and beverage. The reason for the recommendation of the Winnipeg Services is the Urban Planning and Design Division recommend approval of the submitted plans because the proposal incorporates a strong pedestrian-oriented design. That refers to the ground floor, which is one of the important reasons that we supported very, very actively, but wanted to make sure that in your approval, to the extent possible, the committee reminds the proponent that a shortcut and putting other uses there like offices should not be possible and definitely not desirable. By commercial retail units that are customer friendly and pedestrian friendly, we refer to food stores, merchandise stores, food and beverage outlets, but it excludes destinations like lawyers, medical specialists, and accountants, all necessary professionals in the community, but which fit as well on an upper level of an office building. So to consequently, we ask that the Real Community Committee, to the extent that it's possible to do so, and I know it's not the first time we raise this issue, go on record that development is approved as submitted, which includes the use of the designated CRU space on the ground level as retail space and not converted to office space. I wish to add a note which is not written down to congratulate Jonathan for his approach to the CIFM, which I think is a very positive gesture and business strategy, I suspect, but gesture because it creates a really beautiful normal apartment with them in mind and without going necessarily to a designated living center. We wish to extend the proponent our appreciation for the consultation process he participated in, and we thank the Real Community for your consideration of this matter, especially on the matter of the CRUs. Thank you.
Thank you, Walter. Walter, are you aware of any zoning in Winnipeg that has imposed this condition?
I do not believe so, because I raised it before, as you know, you and I have discussed this beforehand, and they've always been told it's limited. I find it strange because the city of Winnipeg imposed a lot of things. Sometimes we don't like them. Most of the time we do like them. But this to me is a fundamental requirement for the future. If we really want active frontage at the street level, which is a policy, and some designs have been changed where, for instance, the parking has been eliminated on stilts and no longer desirable, which I think is a very legitimate objective, as occurred on one of our other projects in St. Boniface on Muscle Street. I think that the next step is to go not only to active storefront, but make it real storefronts. So retail, coffee shops, places that people walk in for services and for goods, rather than what we call in the industry destinations, where people will go there, usually on appointments, and they don't need to go and trip into it from the sidewalk.
Appreciate the presentation. Appreciate the idea as well. My gut tells me that this is likely a zoning condition, not a plan approval, which is more cosmetic in nature. But I will ask the public service about that.
Yeah, I was expecting just a recommendation for the record that you know, guiding them, suggesting, hoping that they are able to fulfill the CRU tenancy with genuine customer-friendly retail tenants.
I was thinking along those non-statutory lines as well, because I think probably, just one second, I got a phone ring. I think that probably in order for it to be, you know, an imposable condition, it should be done at the zoning level, but I will confirm with the clerk, and perhaps I'll ask a follow-up question with the applicant.
I'll apologize to the chairman that this is a bit of a politicking for the Winnipeg Services to consider that in the future as they review various planning documents, that I think there is a popular requirement and expectations from the community.
Now, perhaps a future motion for myself, Walter, but thanks for your recommendation.
I have a question for the plan. Thank you, Walter, by the way, first, I'll come back to that, but question for the planners. Is this one where we originally had a set number of units and then due to reconfiguration, there are fewer units?
We added units.
Additional units.
Additional units, the other way around, okay.
And just Councillor Allard, in response to your question, that is correct. Restricting the type of commercial uses would be something that should have been done if it was desirable through the zoning agreement.
Understood. To your knowledge, has there been any zoning agreement in Winnipeg where these types of restrictions have been imposed?
Not to my knowledge. The zoning district that they rezoned into, the residential mixed use zoning designation, it is already designed to encourage kind of smaller storefronts and kind of the types of commercial uses that are less car oriented and more conducive to, you know, pedestrian main streets.
Understood, thank you. And then in terms of this idea of having a statement encouraging something to that effect, is that something that we can do with a plan approval, or perhaps we can include it as part of the minute? Maybe that's more of a question for the clerk.
My understanding is that any change would be considered an amendment on the plan approval, which would be agreeable if the planner and the applicant and the committee and the public service agrees to it.
Jonathan, would you have any objection to adding language in the plan approval that says that we encourage you to look for retail establishments as described by the Residents Association? So the idea of trying to steer away from offices and trying to look more for retail type uses?
So we're readmitting Jonathan in from the waiting room.
And I mean, my intention would be for this to be non-statutory in a statement and as part of the plan approval.
In terms of retail space, though, is it subject to conditions? I mean, you've got residents living there as well. So are there operating hours that would be considered, or as opposed to if it is an office space where it's usually between 9 to 5 hours, or?
Councillor Chambers, I don't know if that's for the administration, but I understand those types of limitations would have happened at the rezoning stage within the zoning agreement, but I can ask the public service as well.
Okay.
Elise, do you mind confirming my understanding of that?
The question is for Jonathan then.
Yeah, if I could just have my understanding validated, I would appreciate that.
So, within the zoning bylaw, there are use specific standards for retail sales uses within the residential mixed use zoning designation. So there's a limit on the gross floor area of 5,000 square feet, and the hours of operations are limited to between the hours of 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. So that's part of the zoning bylaw already.
And then the zoning agreement is supplementary to the zoning bylaw?
That's correct. It's specific to the context of that specific application and location.
Understood. So my question to the Jonathan, do you have any objection to adding a statement in the plan encouraging you to seek out these types of retail opportunities that are pedestrian orientated and try and steer away from office type environments that include dentists and doctors?
I don't have an issue with the recommendation. The requirement would be, I guess, in my understanding, would be a little more. Well, I don't think it can be done retroactively, but we certainly will endeavor to have a coffee shop and some sort of retail use, as that's an amenity to the building and the residents of the building. Our preference would certainly be, and we will try to attract retail tenants. But if we are unable to for some reason, we don't want to sit on vacant space. I guess in perpetuity would be a little bit dramatic, but we will certainly endeavor, and we would be desirous of having retail tenancies at grade. But that's our preference for sure. So
I think my intention is to amend the plan then to encourage you to seek retail tenants on the main floor. And I understand that I don't have a legal power to do this as part of a plan approval, but we've had a request and I don't see any reason why we can't amend the plan approval with that language in it, with the word encourage, which I think would not be, it's not shall, it is we would like, basically.
Sure, we're certainly amenable to that. That's what we will be trying to accomplish regardless.
Okay. I don't want to get into a debate with Councillor Mays about shall or should. I see the public services weighing in. Elise, do you have something to add?
So if I understand it, what you're suggesting is that you would recommend approval subject to a condition that the developer be encouraged to lease the commercial space to retail?
To promote retail, promote retail that would be amenable to pedestrian activity.
If I may, Elise and Councillor Allard, because this seems to be unconventional, if this is going to delay the, producing the zoning agreement and going back and forth with specific legalese, and that's going to delay our building permit, that is going to be an issue for us. So if we could make sure that it's not misinterpreted and written incorrectly, that should be a shall as opposed to a...
I think the word is, I'm not going to get into shall or should. I would just like to say encourage.
Okay.
And then if we can, Elise, can you weigh in on that? Is this in any way going to potentially delay the application?
No, not if it's just attached to the plan approval decision and it's encouraged and nothing that's, shall or should or anything like that.
Okay, I'm comfortable with that. Jonathan, you've heard, didn't mean to interrupt, Elise. Did you have something else to say?
I'm just to Jonathan's point about the zoning agreement and that approval has been concluded. It's been approved by council. So that will not affect the timing of the coming into force and effect of the bylaw associated with your rezoning and
And then just to close the loop, Walter, does that sound good?
Yeah, I'm happy with that. It's a step in the right direction. And we're all, I think, further informed for the next time to bring up the subject a little sooner in the process, which wasn't possible a few years ago. So I think it's a good step. And I appreciate Jonathan Fried's openness that we discussed it. He never argued against it. He's hoping to do it. And hopefully our bad retail environment will be over by the time the building is open. And a whole bunch of new retailers and restaurants will be anxious to locate there, as they should, because it's a great location.
Thank you. We hope so too.
Okay, great. So thanks for the policy feedback from the Residents Association. Thank you, Jonathan, for the collaborative process and the beautiful building. And Walter, I've learned at City Hall that sometimes what's possible is small incremental steps. Perhaps this is the first time we get this type of language on the record for council's consideration. So congratulations in that, you know, not binding, but small incremental step in those council minutes.
Good. All right, Jonathan, given that our planners in debating the fork said the change from their shall be geothermal to their should be geothermal, had no force and effect, I mean, I wouldn't be too worried about what was put in. I found that a remarkable assertion, but I lost that vote. So don't worry about that, I would say. Walter, thank you for your comments and the recent La Liberté about the debacle that has taken place in Glenwood over the years. That was much appreciated, but the struggle continues. Any further delegations?
No.
All right, on we go then to the thank you. On to the main reports then.
Colleagues, if I could suggest dealing that report right away as some of our delegates are listening about it. Just an idea.
Number four? Yeah,
sure. Yeah, if we could deal with that. I know there's a number of people online listening, so.
So Councillor Lardon moves that we move that to number one. That's fine. Go ahead.
So on plan approval, Elise, if you could guide me with that language to add that supplementary. So I would like to move the Urban Planning and Design Division recommendation approval of the submitted plan with the addition of what we've discussed in the meeting, Elise.
Can you repeat back to me kind of the wording of the condition you were thinking?
Yes, that on the main floor, the proponent or the owner seek or that the Riel Community Committee recommend to the owner that we seek out retail opportunities that are amenable to pedestrians on the main floor.
On that, Madam Clerk.
I wouldn't mind to be able to just confirm with Elise if the wording, if the committee would be amenable to maybe a 5-minute recess.
Yeah, I think that's fine.
So sure, I'll go ahead a cup of coffee. Thank you.
Sounds good. So 10:26.
Sounds good.
Good.
Thank you.
All right, we're back after our recess. Where were we, Madam Clerk? I think ball's in your court.
Certainly. So, Councillor Allard, after speaking with Elise, we would say that this is a condition to be imposed on the plan approval, that the developer be encouraged to locate retail sales uses with a pedestrian orientation in the commercial units on the ground floor, but in noting that this is an encouragement and that we do not have a means to enforce this. Does that sound okay from your end?
Could I hear that one more time, please?
Certainly. So this is a condition that the developer be encouraged to locate retail sales uses with a pedestrian orientation in the commercial units on the ground floor. And in our conversation, noting that this is an encouraged condition and that we do not have an enforcement mechanism for it.
I don't know if Walter and Jonathan are on the line, but if you are, can you confirm this is good?
I think we've lost them.
Oh, I'm here.
No, I understand correct.
Sorry.
I always like closing those loops if I can. So my question, Jonathan, is does that sound okay?
Yeah, that sounds fine to me.
Okay, Walter, are you still there? Okay, well, I think
sorry, you're still on mute.
Yeah, that's fine with me as well. Thank you very much.
Okay, great. Well, we've got 100% alignment. That's always nice when we can get that. So thank you, everyone, for engaging.
Thank you.
So I'll move that motion as amended.
So moved. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That's carried. Back to number one then, Madam Clerk.
Sounds good.
I'd like to move this one. I personally know Dean Scaletta. He presented a council about free canceling library fines. I think he's thrilled that we've gone in that direction. I'm thrilled as well. And I'm pleased to see he wants to continue serving on the library board. So I'd like to move his nomination.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary, carried.
On the citizen appointment for St. Boniface Museum, I'd like to lay over the next meeting. I'm still waiting for a response on a potential candidate.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary, that's carried. Plan approval for Councillor Chambers Ward.
Yeah, I fully support this, as it's going to satisfy, you know, I guess the concerns that many will have after the pandemic with respect to space allotments and how social gatherings are planned going forward. And this will accommodate the same capacity, but the ability to space tables and arrangements out to a greater extent. So I'm very supportive of this measure.
I'll support Councillor Chambers in his ward. I would like the details, though. I mean, given we've got the ludicrous situation where somebody takes out a permit for a starter's hut in 1973 and we deem 60 acres to now be built up instead of prior to 1971, it wasn't built up, even though there was a full-on clubhouse that dates to the 1920s. Literally, that's been our criteria. I'll be interested to see how this addition to a dining room changes the characterization of a large golf course, but so it goes. So all those in favor?
Aye.
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 On to number 520 Island Shore Boulevard. The pretty straightforward one here for you, Councillor Allard.
Can I have a summary of the administration here? I see you're recommending approval.
Yes, sorry, of course. It's the property is located at the corner of Island Shore and Bishop Grandin Boulevards. It's just over 101,000 square feet in area. It contains three commercial buildings surrounding a surface parking lot, which fronts onto Island Shore. And it's located in an area of stability, recent community policy area under complete communities. And it's zone C3 commercial corridor. The proposal is to install a new fascia sign face into an existing sign cabinet above a storefront entrance in one of the buildings on the west side of the parking lot, in addition to a new fascia sign proposed to be installed on the buildings, the same building's tower that's part of that building. Both signs would be illuminated. Under the complete communities direction strategies, areas of stability, recent community policy area, policies relate to low to moderate change through development and redevelopment that's complementary to the existing scale, character, and promoting form of buildings and spaces that are sensitive to the community context. The Urban Planning Division is recommending support of the submitted plans as the proposed signs demonstrate a level of sensitivity to the existing commercial context of the site, low to moderate level of change, given that one of them in particular will be located in an existing sign cabinet, and that the other will be located on the building wall where other signage lettering has been in place previously. So for those reasons, the division is recommending support.
Just a question in terms of why these are coming to community committee.
Right. That's due to the original subdivision and rezoning application from 1985. Its zoning agreement contains a condition that any new development, including signs, be submitted to community committee.
Okay. I thought it was odd to see it. Okay. Thank you for the clarification. I would like to move the Urban Planning Division recommendation.
Councillor Allard moves to waive a citywide plebiscite on the issue. That was a go.
Yes. We need a process for that, Councillor Mays.
Yeah, this I share your question of why is this coming back here, but fair question. All right, Councillor Allard moves the public service recommendation. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, on to number 6142 Provence.
This one I understand why it's coming to community committee. can I have a summary from the administration, please?
Certainly. The proposal here, sorry, I should explain the site a little bit. Obviously, it's located on Provence Boulevard on the south side between Taché and St. Joseph Streets in the central St. Boniface neighborhood of the St. Boniface ward. It's just over 4,000 square feet in area and contains a mixed-use building with two commercial units at grade and three residential units above. It also falls within the boundaries of the Boulevard Provence Plan Development Overlay, or PDO. And under complete communities, it is located along the Provence Boulevard mixed use corridor. And it's also zoned C2 commercial community. And the proposal is to install a new 3-by-18-foot banner sign onto an existing awning above one of the entrances to the building's commercial units. So under the PDO, there's several policies or guidelines related to signs, including that they enhance visibility and building identification, enable orientation and be helpful for wayfinding, be attached to buildings, be lit externally, and be bilingual. So the proposed sign and its location aligns with these policies in our analysis, particularly in contributing to the visibility of the building, its entrance, and the fact that it's bilingual. And under complete communities policies for centers and corridors, there are guiding policies that support active uses such as retail at street level and office and residential on above ground floors, and also promote the conservation of traditional commercial storefronts where practical. And the planning division is again recommending support of the plans, as the proposal aligns with these policies in that the banner will be affixed to an existing awning, which is a feature that contributes to the active uses currently being provided at grade and enhances the existing commercial storefront. So for all those reasons, the division is recommending support.
Excellent, thank you. I do like to see these come to plan approval at community committee, as I've seen many calls to the area councillor when in particular the sign isn't bilingual or other issues. So I'm pleased to move the urban planning division recommendation on this sign. Thanks.
Yeah, these guys are great. These guys actually run the cafe at the aforementioned Sport for Life building that where we had the surface parking lot exemption. So yeah, glad to see them expanding out into St. Boniface. And the marvelous word Torre Facteur, that is a great word for coffee roaster. That is great signage. So yes, happy to support Councillor Ellard on this. So call the question. Sorry.
I agree. Torre Facteur is a great word. Yes.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Contrary, that's carried. Number 7. That's you again.
Yes. So this is hoping for committee support. I was just here recently. There's a clear what's called a desire path. People are walking here. To cross a very busy street, and looking to ask the Standing Committee of Public Works to look into reporting back on the creation of a controlled, separated, or otherwise safe pedestrian crossing at Formore and Spears. It is crystal clear if you go to the Southdale Mall that people are crossing, and obviously it's not safe. I think that's 80 kilometers at that point. And so would like to ask the public service if there's any options. Oh, and I do have pictures to share with the committee. If there's any hesitation, I got to check that out. I was having email trouble earlier.
Yeah, I was going to ask if there was a map or something that you could provide, because I'm trying to visually figure out where this is exactly.
Can we move on to the other reports as I look for the picture?
Sure. I was originally told that EPC I couldn't circulate pictures on something, so I'm actually rather pleased to hear you've got pictures to circulate, and I will duly note that. I know where this is. Windsor Park.
Is that in our procedural bylaw, Councillor Mays? I mean, I certainly don't want to do anything that's not allowed. Could I ask the clerk?
I think you can circulate by hand or by visual.
Right. Normally, in normal times, it would be by hand, but times that we're at right now, I do not know of any rule in the procedure bylaw that does not allow that.
Yeah, I don't recall that event, Councillor Mays. I'm also interested in that.
I agree.
That ruling.
All right, on to number 8, which is you, Councillor Ellard. So we'll hold off on 7 and then.
Yeah, I'll try to find that photo. On 8, we've dealt with this before at this committee. This is a reworded. Motion with a new city planner. My original concern had come from when I had seen a commercial building knocked down with no public hearing, only a permit was required. It was then replaced with a I think it was an illegal parking lot. I'm not 100% sure on that, which was then validated through the Board of Adjustment and then the Board of Appeal. I and a resident appealed the surface parking lot, and we then withdrew our appeal after getting some additional landscaping and trees as part of the parking lot. So sort of a bird in the hand situation. So anyway, that's what happened, and looking to revisit this this question of surface parking lots in our downtown, and hoping for the support of the committee members.
I had a question for me. I'll support, as has been our past practice here, but I would like to see included in this. We've had any number of extensions now, a nice group of people, but any number of extensions on the lot that is east of the Hotel Fort Garry. And I don't know if it's back again. It used to come through the downtown committee every few years, but that committee is no longer with us. So I don't know if that's coming back to P&D, but that's a surface parking lot that's had a temporary extension multiple times. So it may not be illegal. I suppose it isn't in that it's had a number of extensions, but it would certainly be a surface parking lot that's long past the period when we originally said it should be no longer a parking lot.
Yeah, Councillor Mays, that's exactly the lines I'm hoping we can get some policy feedback on. I mean, we have zoning powers and we often see them not applied, as you, as you're pointing out in this case.
Yeah.
In a situation like this, if I may, and just for my edification, what would be the tax portion that we'd be paid? Would it be based on previous building that was there and demolished, or would it be the new legal or illegal parking lot that is there?
Could you restate the question, please, Councillor Chambers? I want to answer in terms of my understanding.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out what the property owner, what taxes would they pay on that property? Would it be based on the previous building that was there and demolished, or would it be based on the legal or illegal parking lot that would currently exist?
It's based on current assessed value. I have in some cases asked our city assessor to come in and weigh in on issues such as this one. I think our city assessor did weigh in on the last motion, which ended up being too complicated to be operable. But my understanding is that the taxes paid for property are based on assessed value. There's also been some work done in the previous term of council, as the mayor had campaigned on surface parking lots, in terms of updating our fee structure around them. So there are additional fees on top of the property tax, but it is based on assessed value. So in theoretically, it would be possible that a surface parking lot might have a higher assessed value than a very small building, for example. But if you compare it to like a significant multi-use, highest and best use downtown building, then of course the property, the incremental taxes are orders of magnitude above that of a surface parking lot. So I think the answer would probably be it depends, but it is based on assessed value, and there are a few additional fees in terms of getting your existing surface parking lot basically up to standards based on a council policy that I think the last council came up with. But public service wants to add anything or has any other information, that's my understanding.
And why is there a difference between commercial and residential in terms of the demolition process?
That is the question that I would like to answer, because if it is a residential building in our wards, there's a public hearing and we can decide yay or nay. But when it's commercial industrial, the building goes down, all of a sudden you've got a surface parking lot, even in a very urban area where council might want to see, you know, like a commercial mixed-use building like the one that we just approved. So hence my question to the public service through this motion.
Okay, and I was about to ask if you were going to do a cross-jurisdictional scan to see what other cities are doing, but I see that is point number two, a cross-jurisdictional stand on best practice for addressing demolitions, which, and I might add then, just looking at how that's worded, adding if there's differences between residential and commercial demolitions in other jurisdictions as well.
If the public service, Council Chambers is asking additional language, can I have some feedback? I did run this motion by the public service, so I know it's a good one from their perspective. I'm not sure about what it is that you're trying to add, Council Chambers.
In terms of other jurisdictions, is there a difference or discrepancy between commercial buildings that are demolished and residential buildings that are demolished, such as the practices here?
Okay, I'm sure. Hearing that, I'm sure that'd be okay. Can the public service weigh in?
I suspect that would probably be covered within point number two.
Okay.
I don't mind being explicit about it if it gets Councillor Chambers' support.
So in the resolve for number two, we can add additional language if that's the will of the committee to add and differences and discrepancies in other jurisdictions. For
commercial and residential demolitions.
For commercial and residential demolitions.
I'd like to move that.
Matt, do you really need the final whereas? I just find that is so broad. I mean, I might say, yeah, I think it's I would have thought it appropriate that Starlight not get a TIF and they pay it. Would you say, well, I would have thought it was appropriate the Gold Eyes would pay their full amount due, to which I would say, well, then we shouldn't have the Jardin de Sculpture. They should be paying, to which you might say, well, the Canoe Club, we got $1 a year or 10,000 or whatever we get. That's not appropriate. I mean, that seems to get undermined, to deflect from your main point, which I think is actually a good point about the vacant lots. But I mean, that, sure, it should be appropriate. And then a massive argument about, you know, is a TIF appropriate? Is a tax, you know, is True North paying what's appropriate? Could we just delete that, the final and whereas? Because I think it.
I'd really rather not, Councillor Mays, considering our climate goals and on our incremental tax possibilities regarding buildings versus surface parking lots. I really would like to keep that clause in there. And on the Jardin des Sculptures, Councillor Mays, you've raised it many times. I just want to say, if ever there were a motion to remove the canoe in your ward, that art piece, which is really basically a similar type park like situation, I would support you in that. I think the Jardin des Sculptures is a very specific situation. I don't think it was ever council's intention to sell it, and I know that you brought it up several times as in your speech about infill and densification. I'm not asking to infill your parks, Councillor Mays, and you keep bringing up the Jardin des Sculptures as if it's some example of something we should be infilling, and I wanted to let you know that if somebody ever says we should be building houses in St. Vital Park, that you would have my support in conserving that park. So
I
wanted to have that exchange with you, because you keep bringing up the sculpture garden, and I really don't think it's an appropriate comparison.
Thank you. I would like to actually correctly state my position rather than the way you stated it. I actually voted in favor and have indicated at committee that they should vote in favor of what you're proposing on the Jardin des Sculptures, because
that support.
An exception, just as there are other exceptions to revenue maximization, just as you suggest that as an exception to the idea, there's nothing that would help us better combat climate change by leaving it as a sculpture garden. Just so, there have been a number of exceptions approved here at council. Alas, none of them in my ward, where we seem to be serving the idea of density maximization. My point
is, I can remember exceptions in your wards, Councillor Mays.
The sculpture, that we could convert that to a 30-story building if we really wanted to. That would generate more revenue. That would generate more density.
I do recall exceptions we made in your ward, Councillor Mays.
I actually agree with you on this. So you're claiming that I want it densified. That is inaccurate. I'm sorry if you've got that impression. But I actually agree with you. There should be some exceptions to the overarching statement that we must generate maximum density in order to meet climate change goals. We seem to have varied from that philosophy in many other areas, such as Armstrong Point, such as Wellington Crescent, such as the Holden neighborhood in St. Boniface, and many others. So I don't know why the battle on climate change ultimately lands at the shore of St. Vital Ward, but that has been our policy to date. But for clarity, no, I don't think we should build on the Jardin de Sculpture. My point here is saying appropriate levels of tax revenue is completely in the eye of the beholder. But if you want it left in, we'll leave it in.
Yes, I would like to leave it in. As and Councillor Mays, I don't think this is a zero sum. I think there are constantly nuances that need to be considered in terms of infill and densification. We have made exceptions in your ward, like when we asked for additional time or public consultation on the St. Vital Fire Hall. On some of these other issues that you've raised, you've raised some at times you've raised motions. Council said no. We've had the debate. But I do want to express that, yes, we need to increase our densification targets in order to meet our climate goals. On the Holden neighborhood, it's an industrial area, and I think it's entirely appropriate what the planning department is recommending there. Not sure we should be densifying in the middle of heavy industrial. The situation in your ward, Councillor Mays, is quite different, and
that's been recognized by those who voted for exceptions for their own ward. It's different in my ward. I agree with you on the whole situation. I agree that we should listen to residents. I agree with the planners when they say, well, we're worried about complaints coming from there. And when I say there have been hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of complaints in Glenwood, I'm told we don't get those calls. We think it's been a success. So I agree, the Holden situation. I agree with that. I support the planning department on that. It's just some complaints seem to matter a whole lot more than others to the planning department.
I think you're making a false argument there, because you're equating complaints to recommendations from the planning department. And the planning department is offering planning advice. And it is true that they don't get the complaints from residents, which is our job. But in terms of good planning, I keep hearing this, and these are my words describing yours, this zero sum argument, and of basically densification at all costs in St. Vital Ward, but not for me. I was driving around my ward yesterday, Councillor Mays. There is so much densification going on in the secondary plan area in North St. Boniface, where we've had community consultations and the secondary plan. We've had our last build almost unanimous support, 78 units that are adjacent to single family residential.
I hate to cut you short, but we do have one more item to get through, and we have to start public hearings by 10:59.
Right. I appreciate that, Marcus. But I wanted to address, I haven't spoken up before. I've heard the speech Councillor Mace has made so many times. It is not densification or nothing else. It's not your ward being singled out. It's not the planning department's role to deal with complaints. They're giving planning advice. The examples you cite in terms of where we're not densifying are complete apples and oranges. And I wanted to take the opportunity to finally rebut that speech that you've been making.
Well, thank you for stating my position on multiple occasions. Actually, there's been a great deal of densification in St. Vital Ward as well, St. Anne's Road, Riel, and Glen Meadow. We have one coming up back for plan approval soon, River and Bishop. Hundreds of units approved, so there has been a lot of densification. Pleased that we listen. Community en premier, as you've said in your article, community en dernier, it appears to have been the philosophy thus far in Glenwood, and from the planning department, who have indicated to me how much they view the lot splitting as a great success, and they want to spread it throughout my ward. Large expansion in my ward, despite hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of complaints. But they've indicated they're worried about complaints coming out of the Holden neighborhood, which I support. I support the limitation on Holden neighborhood. I just wish the people in my ward could get.
It's not about complaints in Holden, Councillor Mays. It's about incompatibilities of uses between heavy industrial and residential.
Might create complaints that they've indicated to me, but you weren't at that meeting. But keep on stating my position however you'd like to do so, Councillor Allard. I will continue to point out it should be a communité en premier in other parts of the wards. In other words, not just your ward. I support preserving Jardin des Sculptures. I support the limits on densification in Holden. I support that. I've supported recognizing the historical character of other wards. I guess it's
okay. I guess I'm pointing out it's not a zero sum. Everything needs to be considered based on its own merit. And communauté en premier is not the planning department's mandate. Their mandate is to build the city,
which is
more sustainable.
That is what you wrote about considerations in your ward, and that's terrific.
We've got a motion on the floor. We've got less than a minute here to start our public hearing.
Well, then let's start the public hearing, Madam Clerk.
I'd like to move the motion. Can we have a vote on it, please?
Would you like to start the public hearing now? Or
let's start the public hearing.
We will recess the regular agenda and begin with the public hearing. If you could call the public hearing to order.
Yeah, I'll call the public hearing to order. We meet today on the Treaty One land, the homeland of the Métis Nation.
Thank you. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the process the committee will follow is that the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application. Next, those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. And finally, the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you're not obligated to do so. And for a more in-depth overview of the public hearing process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing, please consult the public hearing process brochure, which is available on the City Clerk's Department website. Please note that all public hearings are recorded and will be a part of the public record. Should you have any questions about the hearings, please contact the City Clerk's Department. We'll proceed with item number one, which is a proposed closing at Turin Street, west of Panet Road, adjoining 50 and 70 Panet Road under file DAC 7-2020. Again, the committee will hear from the applicant, followed by those in support and those registered in opposition. And finally, those registered for information. The applicant may return to speak and rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. We are letting the participants in. They will be muted and you will be permitted to speak when called upon. Once you have been heard, you can either remain in the Zoom meeting or leave and continue to watch via the city's YouTube channel. If any participants are currently watching the live meeting on YouTube, we ask you to please mute your audio player now. And we would turn it over to our public service to be able to give an overview of the application.
Fire away, Simi.
Hey there, Simi, if we could put you on mute.
We've heard my technical difficulties there. I will. Okay, video. Good morning, councillors. Thank you. So with regard to the demolitions at 256 and 260 River Road, the applicant is proposing to demolish a single family residential.
No,
Turin Street.
Okay, I was a bit thrown there. That is actually not mine. That is, I believe, Kathy Gagnon speaking to that one.
It's Kathy, yeah.
Okay.
I have Kathy Gagnon and Julian Roberts.
Note on Ms. Finnegan's file.
Sorry about
Hello?
That.
All right.
Hello. Good morning.
Kathy, we can see and hear you.
Of course. All right. This is a very straightforward application. It was actually submitted and approved with a slightly different configuration, including all of Turin Street for closing under DAC 3017. Unfortunately, the negotiations for the purchase and sale of the land once closed were not completed, and therefore the earlier approval ran out. So we're starting over again. This time, the slight difference is Cloverdale Paint, being the applicant, is purchasing a portion of Turin Street as described in the report and as illustrated on the miscellaneous plan, still intends to purchase. So basically, we're just coming back because they ran out of time under the first approval.
All right. Anything from planners? Yet. All right, Madam Clerk.
And I'm sorry, Kathy, will Julian be speaking on this, or is it just for questions?
Julian was here in the event the councillors had any questions with regard to the purchase and sale negotiations. Otherwise, he didn't need to be speaking to them to the closing.
Okay, understood. So the only public representation we have registered would be Larry Lazinski. We're just asking for the video. This is, yes, this is the applicant. Hi there, Larry, you can hear us. We're just, oh, there you are.
Yes, I can.
10 minutes on the clock for your presentation.
Well, not much to present. As Kathy Gagnon said, we're just looking to still continue to try purchase the portion of Turin Street that it is adjacent to our properties. I don't know if you have a map there, but we have the five blocks on either side. It takes up about half of Turin Street. Originally, the application was done with Manitoba Hydro, and just delays being what they are, I ran out of time. And I think, everything got missed earlier in the year 2020 when the pandemic started. So I think that got missed as far as the timing. So in any case, we're back to reapply. Nothing's really changed. Our understanding, the price is still the same. And it's just, this time we'll be not doing a joint application with Manitoba Hydro. We'll just do it on our own so that we can try hit the timeline deadline this time. Any concerns or questions?
Yeah, what's the purpose of purchasing this? Is it specific? Are you planning on expansions or is it just access? Yeah.
No, it's there are easements along Turin Street, so we can't build across it. The purpose is just security because there was that plan about 3 years ago that the city of Winnipeg had, and it was going to make Turin Street an active street, and that would be caused irreparable problems for us because we have a tank farm on one side of the street and the plant on the other with pipes running across. We wouldn't have been able to operate in that facility. So this is just security for us. No plans because of the easements to do anything differently on the street portion because there are services running underground there.
Any further questions? If not, thank you. And next.
We do not have anyone registered in support, in opposition, or for information. So at this point, question for the public service once again.
I don't have any questions. I'd be ready to move the public service recommendation. None.
Councillor Ellard, go ahead.
And we have the opportunity for the applicant to speak about anything that he has heard. One last chance, Mr. Lazinski.
No, I'm fine if everyone's good to proceed.
Go ahead, Councillor Ellard.
Right, just pulling up my script. Okay, so I got it. Sorry for the delay. I was looking through the document. I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and forwarded to the Standing Committee Property and Development Heritage and Town Down Development.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I was looking for that that expedited process DPC, but I guess it doesn't apply in this case. Yeah. So I don't see a move to close public hearing. Madam Clerk, is that missing or?
Nope, this is a DAC. So that's
so the public hearing stays open then?
Well, I will conclude that the committee has made a recommendation on this matter and it will now proceed to council.
That is a good procedural question though. Why would we have a public hearing and we close them on other, perhaps we could have the clerks come back to us on that. That's a fair question.
I'd appreciate
I can answer that. Closings must have a public hearing. They don't follow the criteria that you for an opening. I must be able to report that there are no people considered injuriously affected. So it has a great deal to do with under the Expropriation Act and registrations of documents in the Land Titles Office and certain representations that must be made. So they always require to go to the community committee first for a public hearing. But opening applications can, if they meet criteria under bylaw, and forgive me, I've forgotten the exact number from 1998. If they meet five, I think there's five criteria for an opening, they can go skip the committee. And this, but not closings. Closings always have to start at the committee.
Perhaps, Councillor Mays, perhaps more of a legal question than... Yes. Because I am curious, why would we, it doesn't make procedural sense. Why would we open a public hearing and not close it?
It's a fair question. Well, Ms. Ford here will look into that for us.
Thank you, I will. I'll thank you.
All right, on we go then to, do we hear two and three together or do we hear them separately?
So they have been submitted as two separate applications because there are two separate addresses, although the DAS said has gone through to council. I spoke to legal services who says that we may, if we choose, the committee has liberty to hear it as a combined hearing, so long as no one is prejudiced or no one is speaking on one item and not the other. And we do only have the one public representation who is the applicant. So.
Can we move to hear it as a joint hearing?
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Carried. All right, then let's hear from there, Simi and Ms. Yerez. Can we hear from you on? Go ahead.
Sorry, just going to introduce it. So, item two is a demolition at 260 River Road under file DEMO224634-2020D. And this will be a combined hearing, as we've discussed. And we will also be hearing of 256 River Road DEMO224648/2020D. And additional communication was received in support of the matter after the agenda was published, which has been distributed to all members of the committee as of Friday. And the committee will hear the applicant, any in support, any registered in opposition, any for information, and then the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal. We have everyone muted and they will be permitted to speak when called upon. Once you've been heard, you can either remain in the Zoom meeting or leave and continue to watch via the city's YouTube channel. So any participants that are currently watching the live meeting on YouTube, please mute the audio player. And now, yes, please, let's send it over to the planner for an overview. Simi.
Thank you. Take two. Good morning, councillors. The applicant is proposing to demolish a single family residential building at 256 River Road and a single family residential building with accessory structures at 260 River Road. This is to address site maintenance and safety issues ahead of construction. Construction of a multifamily residential development to be constructed this year. This was approved, as earlier mentioned, last year by the Riel Community Committee on June 25th, 2020, where it was a subdivision and rezoning application. DAS said 4 of 2020 was approved for 252, 256, and 260 River Road, as well as 81 Blackmore. And there is a diagram there in the report that shows in green outline the area for the proposed development. And this also, this also includes an undeveloped public lane. The application, I'll skip forward a little bit. So 256 and 260 River Road are located there on the west side of River Road between Bishop Grandin and Blackmore Avenue in the Minnetonka neighborhood of the St. Vital Road. Both properties are located with the area within the areas of stability recent communities policy area under the complete communities direction strategy, currently zoned R1M and rezoned, of course, to RMFS. So I just realized that I was about to become state some duplicate information there. So the public service is recommending approval of both demo applications to undertake demolition of the existing buildings to address the risks associated with trespassers on site. And this will also allow the sites to be prepared in order to, for the upcoming development outlined, outlined ahead of, before, pardon my notes here. these demo applications don't contravene the development procedures bylaw specifically. They don't create pressures for new land use, and they wouldn't create a visual detriment or negative impact on the maintenance and use of adjoining or adjacent properties. The development of the two multifamily residential buildings has already been approved, and plans have been submitted as part of that application. The applicant has worked very collaboratively and provided a full set of drawings with that application, which will not likely require any substantial revision. So it's anticipated that the timeline to obtain their building permits will be quite soon. Furthermore, it's not expected that the applicant would neglect the maintenance of the property or leave it vacant, given their approval and current timeline. I can speak further to that. Thank you.
Doesn't look like there are any questions. So on to our delegate then, please.
Yes, just the one delegate. We have the applicant, Louis Pereira, who is with us on Zoom. And you have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation, Mr. Pereira.
Awesome. Thank you, Simi. Good morning, councillors and clerks. I am Louis Pereira, president of Sherwood Developments 2016 Limited. And as already see me preluded to, I'm here to talk about the demolition of two homes at 256 and 260 River Road. Just going to do a quick little screen share here. And the reason why I'm choosing to apply for demolition variance is because looking to demolish these homes prior to having our full building permit in place for our new multifamily development. And as a recap, in June of 2020, we got approval at the public hearing to develop two four-story buildings on these properties with 128 units. The current status of the development is that our engineered drawings are 99% complete, and that we'll be applying for the building permits for both buildings within 2 weeks. And our goal is still to commence construction in May of this year. Now, the reason why I'm requesting that the city allows us to demolish these homes prior to having our building permits in place is because the house located at 260 River Road, which is the one that you see here in the picture, it is vacant, it is boarded, but yet people are breaking into this home. And actually, I'll go back to that picture. We've put lag bolts through the door, and yet people are still continuing to break in. They're actually removing the bolts, which just kind of confounds me. I've been told by people in the community that this particular house and garage was known for illegal activities in the past, including the selling of drugs. I can only assume that the people who are breaking into this property have ties to those illegal activities. And people breaking in is obviously a liability for my company, and it's a liability for the community. And I fear that if somebody were to try to, spend the night in this property, that the probability of starting a fire is very high. And I definitely do not want these liabilities, nor would anybody. I think it's really a matter of time until there is an event at this location where it would require the services of the Winnipeg Police Department or the Fire Department, or possibly both. So rather than having these liabilities, we just ask that you allow us to demolish these homes, which I remind you, if it was not for these break-ins, we would be demolishing them within a few months anyways. So I'd also like to add the fact that we've already fenced off the entire property prior to the ground freezing. So once approved, we are prepared to demolish these homes and eliminate this liability for all. And that is essentially it. So if you have any questions, let me know.
Thank you for the presentation. I don't think anything rides on if people are breaking in to do something illegal. Well, doesn't really ride on what they're doing if they're breaking in. Thank you for the presentation. If there are no other questions. And then, so the plan is to start construction of the new buildings that were approved in 2020, that the plan would be to start construction in 2021.
No, to start in May of this year. So in a few months.
So yes.
So yes, in 2021, May of this year.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Thank you to council.
Still getting my year straight.
That's all. There was a condition, actually I'll save my comment. There was a traffic condition that's coming to Councillor Allard's committee, I think this month or next month, that was kind of, that was vital to the viability of this project. So he'll be some traffic recommendations coming very soon, I suspect, at that at the infrastructure committee, and that was vital to getting this this development moving forward. I'd say these homes will be missed by all election candidates who ever desperately tried to get a large yard sign on the front yard because it's such a high traffic area. But I can't think of anyone else who's ever said to me they'll miss these houses. So I don't, and the demolition would be as soon as possible if approval is given, or is there?
Yes, exactly. The home at 260 River Road, we would like to demolish as soon as possible once approvals are given. The second house, 256 River Road, we still have an agreement with the previous owner. We're allowing them to stay there on the property until we get a little bit closer to actually breaking ground. But they're not the ones that are creating the concerns. It's the vacant home 260, which we want to do some immediate action on.
Okay.
I can't but notice the irony in the sense that earlier this morning we were dealing with a property where we're talking about the demolition of a commercial property, which is different than a residential property. And now we're asking for the same conditions of the residential property as we are the commercial property. So a little bit of irony there. I understand the urgency by which you want to get this done, recognizing that there is activity going on there, probably even more so when conditions are colder, and the potential for somebody to break in there and try to heat the home, if it's cold outside, could potentially be quite adverse. So duly noted.
All right, if there are no further questions, Madam Clerk, on to the next delegation.
We have no further delegations registered.
That speeds that up.
So we would transfer over to the public service and then to the applicant again to hear in rebuttal.
Public service going once, going twice, no? All right. Mr. Pereira, anything? There's really nothing to rebut. There's no evidence that's been put in. But any clarifying comments you'd wish to make?
That's pretty much it. It's just if it weren't for the break-ins, we'd be tearing it down in a few months. But because of the activity that's taking place, it's just, I think, in everyone's best interest that we knock it down now and eliminate that issue.
Fair enough.
Take this one. Ready to move a motion?
I was going to make some comments. I'll give you the chair. And yeah. Okay. Seeing no further discussion, I'll hand the chair to Councillor Chambers. Madam Clerk, do we do them both at once then, or do we deal with 260 and then 256?
Okay.
All right. So we're rolling then on 260. I'll move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Then Councillor Allard's point. What? It's a fair point. I'll move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I'll move that the recommendations to the Winnipeg Public Service is concurring with the developer here in all respects. Ms. Finnegan, this is approved for demolition. Public service position is to approve for demolition. Yeah, with the conditions. Correct, yeah. Okay, very good. I'll move that the recommendations of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I assume the criteria are being satisfied then?
Correct.
In terms of supporting comments, this is a development that I moved approval of. It's 128 infill units. Goes toward our 50% densification target. It is not in the mature communities, but as I pointed pointed out of council, the 50% target is not simply in the mature communities. It's not simply in the mature communities. It's in the intensification area, which includes basically everything in the whole city except Sage Creek, Waverly West, and bits of Councillor Sharma's ward, I believe. So this then counts as infill. It counts toward the target. It's something I approved. Ironically, after we had that hearing and there were 500 people in opposition, somewhat ironically, I was then got an email from someone in the planning department saying I opposed infill because I don't like complaints. So I Ms. Finnegan backed me up on that. I appreciate that. When I said, actually, I just approved a building that I thought was appropriate for the location that is infill, despite hundreds of people being in opposition, I thought it was appropriate for the neighborhood. So that planner isn't with us today, but I've certainly had discussions with them and with their superiors since then to indicate people shouldn't be circulating emails from the planning department indicating that I oppose all infill because I don't like complaints, when in fact I've just approved a very large project here and a very good project for Mr. Pereira. Admittedly, it does need some traffic control. That should be coming to Councillor Allard's committee, if not this month, then the next month. Actually, remarkably good cooperation with David Patman and company on traffic issues to date. So yeah, what we need to take these things down in order for that thing to go up, as indicated, these at least this one I think is the more problematic of the two, where that the main goal for the public seemed to be getting election signs up there at elections, but otherwise I don't think it'll be a structure that's missed in the neighborhood. There was some controversy about proceeding with that infill project, an infill project which along with my two colleagues here I approved back at our June meeting, but I'm hopeful that the traffic measures will help reduce some of the concerns of the citizens. Obviously, we have other areas where the planners have listened to concerns of the citizens. Hopefully, we can see more of that in the future. But in any event, I'll move item, what the criteria under Part 9, Section 46.3 of the Development Procedures Bylaw, number 104, 2020, are satisfied.
All in favor?
Aye. I'll move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
On to two, Madam Clerk, do you need to, or eight, or am I on to 256?
Yep, you can just proceed with the motions for the next one and then I will close it after.
Well, I'll move that the report, I'll move the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I'll move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I'll move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I'll move that the criteria under Part 9, Section 46.3 of the Development Procedures Bylaw, number 104, 2020, are satisfied as per the reasons given, the comments and support given at number two on the agenda, the 260 River Road, acknowledging that there may still be occupants in one of these buildings. I think this one, but the same comments apply.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
I'll move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. And in the words of Miley Cyrus, it hit me like a wrecking ball.
Please note that the committee's decision with respect to this application may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so is included in the order issued, which will be mailed to all persons registered.
Thank you.
Thank you. Back to the main agenda. Item number 8 has been moved by Councillor Allard. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That's carried. One to go then, because Madam Clerk, perhaps for the first time ever, do we not have any other new business?
Not that I know of.
Remarkable. That is perhaps unprecedented. Turn the chair to Councillor Chambers. Number 9 is one of mine. This is an opportunity that would save the city a lot of money. Roughly 20 to 25 years ago, money was paid into the future services account. There are actually only two of these left in St. Vital Ward. Almost all of them are inherited by Councillor Chambers. The the ones that were paid in St. Vital. There's a $500 one that'll never come out. There's this one, future services item that was paid in by either Home Depot or Shindico when the Home Depot went in at northwest corner of St. Anne's and Bishop. Okay, that money's been sitting there, not earning interest, as we know about the future services account. We now have an opportunity to improve a play structure, which oddly is a city play structure, though it's near a school. The school is near this intersection. In order to attract provincial funding, we need to have 10% private funding for the project with the play structure. The proposal here is to take 20,000 out of the 119,900 that has been paid in. And with the concurrence, we'd need the concurrence of Home Depot and or Shindico, Home Depot or Shindico, whoever paid it in. If we can get that 20,000, then we can access the provincial money. So there's no loss to the city here. It's money that's being held. There's no, in fact, it's a gain to the city in order to access the substantial provincial funds. And I've talked with the local MLA, Rochelle Squires, about this project on a number of occasions, and she's certainly interested in being part of this project. Here's a chance to get 20,000 in private money, and we can then go forward, saving the city quite a bit of money because we've been able to access provincial funding. That probably sounds confusing the first time through, but the long and short of it is we have money in a reserve. We've had it there for over 20 years. It hasn't been earning any interest. If we can take 20,000 of it, it'll save us roughly $65,000 to $75,000 out of our city coffers because it'll allow us to access provincial funding. It is, I won't get discussed it with various members of the public service, obviously not in this. Finnegan, it's not a planning matter, but this would go, I assume, Madam Clerk, to the Finance Committee.
It would go to PP&D.
Ah, as custodians of the future services.
Right.
All right. And admittedly, if we don't have, the money's held in trust. If the party that paid in the money doesn't want it to come out for this, it's not coming out, as is our case with innumerable other future services accounts. So moved.
So all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, carried. This is great in the sense of drawing down on provincial dollars that would go towards enhancing the playground structure at Victor H. L. Wyatt School. That is nearing is quite aged. It's interesting to me, since being elected, looking at the different playgrounds and the playground structures that are there, you can kind of date when they were installed just by their composition or you know how they've evolved to be more accessible for those individuals with disabilities. So a great move on your part to draw down on some of that federal or provincial
funding. Hopefully, yeah. And for clarity, we don't need the agreement on all the future services accounts, because some of them we're going to spend as they were intended back in the 70s, 80s, 90s, mostly in Councillor Klein and Councillor Chambers' ward. We've got money there to pave some roads. We're going to go pave some roads. This obviously was paid in for a different purpose, but it's been sitting there. So here's our chance to get some use out of it.
Okay.
All right. Incredibly, no other items, Madam Clerk?
We should return to item number 7.
Thank you. Good point.
Allard's motion.
Yes, and he just sent an email with some photos. That's correct, Councillor Allard?
I did, yeah. So I'm standing in front of the Desire Path, so it's clear there's pedestrian traffic going there. It's going over a high-speed road. Clearly, that's not safe. So that's what I want Public Works to investigate. What are the solutions? I made a couple of suggestions, but certainly not being prescriptive. And so I'd like to move that up to Standing Committee to hear back from the Public Service on how we might ameliorate situations like this one, and perhaps even expand the search across the city. But for now, I wanted to bring it up as a ward issue.
So just noting there in the photograph below where you're standing, It's an aerial view of the subject site. And I'm noticing that there's a number one maple leaf there designated as Trans-Canada Highway. Is there anything federally that has to be resolved as this is a federal road?
There may be interjurisdictional considerations, and I expect the Public Service would be able to clarify that at the Standing Committee.
Okay.
Is there a sidewalk there on the south side?
Yeah, I think there are sidewalks, but I think the point of the motion, I guess, is that clearly these are the established patterns that people are using, and they're not safe. So crossing or no crossing, we've got a problem.
We've got a similar, well, not, we've got a situation in Sage Creek where sidewalk's been approved, but there's no sidewalk to connect to. So we're trying to work that through. So hopefully this, something along these lines will go through for this one. Although as Council Chambers said, there may be highway number one issues there, but we'll see. All right. Without further discussion, then we'll call the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That's carried.
Move adjournment.
All those in favor of adjournment?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. We are adjourned.